dance in the darkness. I'm caught up in your love like a silhouette. Your light always finds me. I got nowhere else to hide like a silhouette. Silhouette.
What's up, everybody, and welcome to Watch Party Christmas Edition. That's right. My name is Larry. I'm the resident student pastor at our Braselton campus, and I've got some friends with us tonight. We have some fun things planned. Down here on the end is my friend Justin. Justin is from the Snellville campus. Welcome.
Yes, sir.
Good to have you, brother.
Thank you.
And right here, representing Hamilton Mill, we have Belle. Say hello to the people, Belle.
Hey, guys.
And Maddie.
Hi.
And we're ready for some Christmas festivities. But first, I got to know something. What is your guys' favorite Christmas movie? Because there's a lot of good ones out there. I got to know. What's the best? Justin, best Christmas movie?
It has to be the classic Elf, man. Buddy the Elf.
Buddy the Elf.
Buddy the Elf.
He's just a legend, isn't he?
He really is.
He really is.
The man, the myth, the legend.
The man, the myth, the legend. Belle, how about you? Favorite Christmas movie?
Has to be The Grinch. It just hits different.
Which Grinch?
The cartoon.
What? The cartoon version?
The cartoon.
The new one?
Yeah.
Netflix? The Grinch.
If it's on Netflix, it's good.
Yeah. Yep, there it is.
Okay.
Maddie, how about you?
Definitely Christmas Vacation.
Christmas Vacation. It is. We love the Griswolds.
Yeah, we do.
Clark Griswold.
The best.
What a guy.
What a guy.
Great. Yeah. Great. Well, speaking of Christmas, we've got a nice Christmas-themed game that we're going to play. So why don't we head on up here and get ready for our game. Guys, we're playing a game called Candy Cane Catch. And let me just explain to you how this is going to work. So each of our contestants are going to pick up five of these lovely peppermint candy canes right here. And as you see, this garland is laid out between these tables. Their goal is to take their candy canes, toss them, and land them right on this garland. And whoever makes the most takes the cake. That's it.
Right.
So we're going to get ready to to do this thing. Maddie, are you going first?
I guess so.
All right, Maddie, our first contestant in Candy Cane Catch. Why don't you go for it?
Okay, we're just gonna go for it.
See what you got.
All right.
Okay, that was a great starting point. Continue. Yeah. Here we go. Let's continue to improve.
I don't think that
okay.
was fast.
Okay, you got this. Okay, okay, we need to pause.
Okay,
two left. You have two left.
This one's a little broken, so it might be rigged a little bit, but it's okay.
No, you got this. Okay.
All right, one more.
Deep breath, Maddie. One left.
Dear God, help me.
Here we go.
Okay, here we go.
Jesus, take the wheel.
And not that time.
All right, well, thanks for playing. We're 0 for 5, folks. 0 for 5. Belle, welcome. It's your turn to show us how to play Candy Cane Catch. I think you can do it.
Hopefully.
Here we go. 5 attempts. Show us what you're made of. Okay.
Okay.
Very direct approach
here.
Yeah. Very direct. Okay, you're coming up a little bit short. Let's put a little bit of extra oomph on it. Holy cow.
Can that count?
No, it can't count. But I will agree that you got robbed a little bit. But you got two left.
Just
two attempts.
A little bit.
Let's
that
go,
so
Belle.
Good.
Let's go. Give me some.
Yay.
Good stuff. Okay.
Okay.
You got one left.
Hey, I got one.
You got one. She got one. Okay. Nobody can take that away from you. It doesn't matter how many this guy gets. You got one.
It's zero.
All right, but Justin. Justin, why don't you come on up? All right.
All right.
For the win, to take this home for Snell Vegas, you got to make two.
For Snell Vegas, man.
All right.
That
Holy
worked.
Cow, the
but
no look.
Go.
You missed by like that much, okay? You're right around it.
Ooh, it's right there.
It is
Come on,
right
Snell
there.
Vegas.
Okay, deep
for
breath.
For
this is
tie.
It. One more.
For you, Snell Vegas.
Happy holidays.
Let's go!
Oh my goodness.
Let's
okay.
Go.
All right, it's sudden death. It is sudden death.
Sudden death.
So we're going to take one shot at a time until somebody makes it. Here you go. Belle, why don't you go first?
Oh,
you
both.
Let's see what you're made of.
Oh.
That's not going to do
went
it.
Sideways.
All right.
For the
Next
win.
Up, Justin
on,
for the
Vegas.
Win.
Yay.
That was not cool. All right. Here we go. Let's keep doing this thing.
Am I going first
Belle?
Again?
Okay. Okay, an attempt for Justin. You have to make it.
Come on. Come on, Snell Vegas.
That was so clutch,
Don't
by the
leave
way.
Me now. Don't leave me now, Snell Vegas. No!
And that's going to do it. Everybody, well done.
Yes.
Belle, your champion. Give her a round of applause. Insane talent in the Candy Cane Catch. But guys, wherever you are at your watch party, you're gonna have a chance to play some Candy Cane Catch. So why don't you do that, and we'll see you back in a minute. Hey, everybody. Hope you enjoyed some Candy Cane Catch. And that's going to do it for us, though. So we're going to throw it over to Tasha for some worship. Oh, wait. Hold on. Come back here. I almost forgot. We're doing a really cool thing right now as a church, and we're partnering with an organization called Jambos. And Jambos, they focus on donating pajamas to kids in the foster care system. See, you might not know, there are over 150,000 kids in the foster care system in our area, and we get the opportunity to gift them with some Christmas pajamas. So next week, we're gonna be collecting some pajamas that we can give to Jambos and help some kids in the foster care system enjoy this holiday season. So bring some pajamas next week. Don't forget. So that's gonna do it for us, and we're gonna throw it over to Tasha for worship.
What's up, guys? My name is Tasha. I'm here with Esther. We're just here with the band getting ready for worship tonight. We're super excited to be able to worship with you guys. But tonight we're going to sing about the goodness of God and God's love, and God's love frees us up from performance.
Yeah, so what that means is that when we worship, you can just come as you are. You don't have to put on a performance. You don't have to be perfect. Just bring yourself and sing loudly, sing badly. It doesn't matter. We're just here to worship God, and He's worth it. So let's go after it.
shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. The snow wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. The snow shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up.
Yeah.
go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath repeat the sound. All his children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus.
Beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. The name above all names, the name to which every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord. And he's a good Lord, he's a good Savior, he's a good King. So Jesus, thank you for who you are. I pray that in every room, in every house, wherever anyone listening to this may be, I pray that you would encounter the love of Jesus tonight. Maybe it's in a renewing of that. Maybe it's for the first time. But Jesus is our Savior and our Lord and our good King. A friend that is with us always, never leaves us, never forsakes us. So God, thank you for who you are. Thank you for what you've done. I pray all this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Hey guys, thanks for worshiping with us. Now it's time to grab your Bibles, pens, and notes and get ready for this week's message.
Hey, what's up, y'all? Can you believe it's December already? Now, it's finally socially acceptable to listen to Christmas music. For all you people who listened to it before Thanksgiving, what is your problem? Does it feel to you like it's been one really long week from March until now? I feel that way. But with the start of a new month comes the start of a brand new series that we are calling Why I Believe In. And the point of the series is really simple. We want to talk about, as a student ministry family, why we believe in Jesus. That part's really simple. But what's not simple is getting on the same page about which Jesus we're talking about. Because I don't know about you, but it seems to me like it's not always clear which version of Jesus we're talking about. Everyone has something different that comes to mind when we talk about Jesus. And it's because it's not always the same, sometimes it feels less like we all know what we're talking about, and it feels a little bit more like this.
Dear Lord, baby Jesus, we thank you so much for this bountiful harvest of Domino's, KFC, and the always delicious Taco Bell. I just want to take time to say thank you for my family. Dear tiny infant Jesus.
Hey, you know, sweetie, Jesus did grow up. You don't always have to call him baby.
Well, look, I like the Christmas Jesus best, and I'm saying grace. When you say grace, you can say it to grown-up Jesus or teenage Jesus or bearded Jesus or whoever you want. Dear tiny Jesus, your golden fleece diapers with your tiny little fat balled up fist pawing.
He was a man. He had a beard.
Look, I like the baby version the best. Do you hear me? I win the races and I get the money.
Ricky, I like to picture Jesus as a ninja fighting off evil samurai.
I like to think of Jesus like with giant eagle's wings, yeah, and singing lead vocals for Lynyrd Skynyrd with like an angel band.
Hey, Cal, why don't you just shut up?
Okay. Maybe it's not as ridiculous as 8 pounds, 6 ounce baby Jesus, but you get the point. We all have our own understanding of Jesus that comes to mind when we talk about Jesus. And so it's important for us to begin the series tonight getting on the same page about which Jesus we're talking about. But I don't want to just skip past that. I want to take a second, and I want us to talk about that in our community groups, because I want to see for you what comes to mind when you think about Jesus. So talk about these with your group. The first is this: should you be allowed to listen to Christmas music before Thanksgiving? I already gave you the answer beforehand. And the second question is, what comes to mind when you think about Jesus? Talk about it. I'll see you in a couple minutes. So hopefully you didn't have anybody who actually thinks that you can listen to Christmas music before Thanksgiving. And if you did, pay attention, because that's who needs Jesus in your group. Like, they're probably the people who also prefer Chick-fil-A over Zaxby's, so they don't really know what they're talking about anyway. Now, as we talk about Jesus and who he is really, I want to begin actually by talking about who Jesus isn't. Because all of us for sure have our own understanding of who Jesus is, but I think for some of us, we've actually got some misunderstandings of who Jesus is. And actually, I said it earlier, Jesus has a long history of being misunderstood. And when he was alive and he was on the earth, there's actually two big misunderstandings that came from two unlikely groups of people about Jesus. The first misunderstanding came from Jesus's disciples. And I want to call that Genie Jesus. I got my friend the Genie right here from Aladdin. Genie Jesus. And the second misunderstanding came from the Pharisees, or these are the pastors of Jesus' day. And I'm going to call that misunderstanding Scoreboard Jesus. I think it's pretty cool, right? Scoreboard Jesus. Genie Jesus and Scoreboard Jesus. Now listen, both of these misunderstandings came from two unlikely groups of people, because both the disciples and the Pharisees were close to Jesus. And I think for many of us, whether you feel like you've been close to Jesus in relationship or proximity, maybe you've been in church for a while, or maybe you just started coming, but you've been developing this relationship with Jesus, I think people like us who have been close to Jesus are actually in danger of having an understanding of Jesus that's more like Genie Jesus or Scoreboard Jesus. And look, it's killing our relationship with the real Jesus. So tonight, I want us to look at a couple of stories in the life of Jesus that show who he is really. And the first story that we're gonna talk about is Matthew's story. Matthew's story, it covers the story, the misconception about who Jesus was to the disciples. See, the disciples, they think that Jesus is this person called the Messiah, who's this long prophesied historical character who's going to be a person who comes in and saves the Jewish people. He's going to come in and free them from Roman rulership and oppression. And so Jesus and his disciples are actually off on a trip, and the disciples bring this up to Jesus. Peter actually says, Jesus, I think you're the Messiah. And the best part is that Jesus says, Peter, you're right. And the disciples, their minds are blown. It's like, what in the world is going on right now? This guy is who we thought he was. But then after Jesus says that he's the Messiah, he keeps talking, like he doesn't stop. And he goes on to say in the story that Matthew writes in verse 21, that from that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and on the third day raised to life. Now, Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, never, Lord, this shouldn't happen to you. And Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block to me because you don't have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. Now, let's stop right there for a second, because we just jumped straight into the story. But in order for it to make the most sense, you have to know what's going on leading up to the story. And something that we tend to forget about Jesus is that he's a real person who was born into a real time. He's not just a character off in a galaxy far, far away. He was born into a real family in a real culture. And he had a real job. And we actually get to back this up because there's a historian in the Roman period named Flavius Josephus. Yeah, Josephus. Josephus is this Roman historian who doesn't follow Jesus, but actually wrote about Jesus in his book called Jewish Antiquities. Here's what he said about Jesus. Check this out. It says, at this time, there was a wise man called Jesus, and his conduct was good, and he was known to be virtuous. Many people among the Jews and other nations became his disciples. Pilate condemned him to be crucified and to die, but those who become his disciples did not abandon his discipleship. They reported that he'd appeared to them 3 days after his crucifixion and that he was alive. Now, this is written by a person who did not believe that Jesus was who he said he was, but he's writing things that we know through scripture. So he's backing up that Jesus is not just this character off in a galaxy far, far away. He's a real human being. And being a real human being, he had a real job in a real culture. Now, Jesus was born into the culture of the Jews. And his job was that of a rabbi, or basically he was a pastor. And so it was part of the culture of Jewish rabbis, or the job that Jesus did, that they would have these students or disciples. And these people would follow them for years on end. And what the rabbi would do, what Jesus did as a pastor in his time, is he would have gone to school, gotten educated, and learned the 613 laws that God gave to the Israelites, the Jewish people, back in Exodus. And knowing what those laws were, he would teach them to the people that followed them and help them to be able to practice those laws for themselves. So Jesus, in this conversation, is talking with his disciples. Now, his disciples had been with him for 3 years. They've walked with him, they've eaten with him, they've traveled where he's traveled. Like, if anybody knows who Jesus actually is, it should be the disciples, right? And yet, look at the story. This story shows that even the disciples misunderstood who Jesus was. See, the disciples got into this misconception about Jesus, this misunderstanding about Jesus, that Jesus was like a genie for them who, if they wanted it, he gave it. If they needed protected from bad things, it was his job to do it. But I think the truth that Jesus is trying to show us, and the truth that he was showing the disciples in the story, is that Jesus is not on our agenda. We're on his. Like, Jesus isn't on our agenda. We're on his. And check this out. I think a lot of us struggle to believe in Jesus because he didn't show up the way that we thought he should. Right? Like, we had a thing that we wanted really badly, and we asked him for it, and he didn't give it. We had pain that we asked Jesus so much to protect us from, and he didn't. And because Jesus didn't show up the way for us that we thought that he should have, we struggle to believe if he's real at all. But let me ask you a question. What if that version of Jesus, genie Jesus, never existed anyway? What if genie Jesus was never who Jesus claimed himself to be? But don't judge the disciples, because they're not the only people who got this wrong. And this is where the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, basically the other pastors of Jesus' day, come into play. They had an understanding of Jesus too. See, remember, rabbis knew the law. They knew the 613 laws that God gave the Israelites in Exodus. And so what their job was to teach and to help the people that they were leading practice what these laws were. But they also were the enforcers of the law. And so when people broke the law, it was their job to deal with it. And so they had a long history of that being their job as rabbis, and they assumed that this is what Jesus would do as well. The rabbis of Jesus, they assumed that Jesus' primary concern would be about keeping and enforcing the rules. But Jesus was really different than what they thought. And John writes about that in his story in chapter 8, verse 2. He says this: at dawn, he, being Jesus, appeared again in the temple courts where all the people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. Now the teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now what do you say?" And Jesus said, "Let any of you who's without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." And at this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left with the woman still standing there. And Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" "No one, sir," she said. "Then neither do I condemn you," Jesus declared. "Go now and leave your life of sin." You see what Jesus did there? See, there's a difference between the rabbi's understanding of Jesus and the reality of Jesus. The rabbis thought that Jesus would primarily care about, the first thing that he would care about, was keeping and enforcing the rules. But Jesus' primary concern was not about what the woman was doing. He was concerned about the woman. Now, let me be clear. Jesus is concerned about the rules. It's just not his first concern. Look at what he said to the woman. He said, "Neither do I condemn you. Now go and leave your life of sin." See, the rabbis were concerned about the woman's performance, but Jesus was concerned first about her. And there's a deep truth that I think Jesus wants us to know in there, and it's this: Jesus loves you more than what you do. He loves you more than what you do. And I think, honestly, some of us don't want to believe in Jesus because we think that the only thing that he's concerned about is with us keeping the rules, right? We think that Jesus is just this giant scoreboard who's only measuring the moments that we got it right and the moments that we got it wrong. And we can only be loved by Jesus when the score is in our favor. When what I did right is more than what I did wrong today. And what Jesus is showing the rabbis, what he's showing the woman, is that he cares about you more than he cares about what you do. Jesus does have an agenda. Remember, we're on his agenda. And his agenda for us is that you would know and experience how much that he loves you. Now, let me be clear. He does care about the rules. But he cares about the rules because he has a way of doing life that is so much better than the way of life that we do it on our own. And it's out of his love for us that he wants us to have a better way of doing things. He cares about the rules, but it's not the first thing that he cares about. The first thing that Jesus cares about is you. I want to take a second right here and pause because I don't want to breeze past this. And I want to talk about this in our groups together because I think that this could help some of us make sense of who Jesus is to us and how we understand Jesus. So which version of Jesus are you tempted to believe in? Is it Genie Jesus, where Jesus is on your agenda? Or is it Scoreboard Jesus, where you feel like the only thing that he cares about, or at least the first thing he cares about, is how well you're performing? Which version of Jesus are you tempted to believe? And why is that? Talk about it with your group. I'll see you in a couple minutes. Thank you. So, now that we're clear on who Jesus isn't, we can be clear about who Jesus is. Because I think that the disciples' version of Jesus, Genie Jesus, and the Pharisees' version of Jesus, Scoreboard Jesus, are really their best attempt to describe something that Jesus embodied that they'd never seen before, which is Jesus as Savior and Jesus as Lord. See, at the heart of Genie Jesus, there's this knowledge that we know that we have need and Jesus has the ability to meet it. Like we have things that we can't do for ourselves that only Jesus can do. And that's what we're talking about when we say Jesus is our Savior. And at the heart of Scoreboard Jesus is this longing for a better way of life, a longing for doing things a different way than what we've been doing. And that's what we're talking about with Jesus as Lord. It's living life the way that he designed it versus the way that I want to. Knowing full well that the life that he's designed for you is ultimately for your good. And the good news about all of this is that who Jesus is really is who we've been hoping he would be all along. He's not this cold, distant scoreboard who only cares about your performance. And he's not this genie who gives you whatever you think you want in the moment that you want it. He's your Savior who loves you so much. And he's your Lord who wants what's best for you and gives you everything that you need in order to live life the way that he asks you. Now, I know this is a lot to take in, but I want to make it practical for you. And I'm going to invite you to ask yourself a question this week. The question is this: who do I think Jesus is really? Who do I think Jesus is really? And be incredibly honest with yourself, because here's what I imagine might be true for you. You may know the answer in your head. Like you may know what the right answer is, but you may not actually believe that in your heart. So ask yourself, who do you think Jesus is really? And be brutally honest, because I think that if you're honest with yourself about who Jesus is really, it opens up the door for you to ask Jesus to show himself and who he really is to you. And if you do, I think the version of Jesus that you'll find is the one that you've been hoping for all along.
That was such a great message. And I know we're all so excited for next week, but the night's not over yet. It's time to jump back into our community groups for some more discussion.